Welcome to my presentation today here from Germany for the Baltic States for the winter seminar of Rapul and Saatenunion. My name is Jan Böse. I'm the product manager at NPZ. NPZ is one of the shareholders of Saatenunion, and my today's topic is field beans and peas, information about the market, breeding goals and production for well-adapted varieties. And we will start with some information about the markets regarding beans and peas. And as you can see here, this is the actual overview in the European countries. We want to focus on the main markets. For us, the most important market is the UK, with over 188,000 hectares beans. To have a closer look at the Baltic states, we see that all in all together, the three countries reach together about 95,000 hectares of beans, and this is quite interesting to see the development since the last 3 years. It's still rising, and we hope for future that there will be a plus of the production in the Baltic countries as well. For us as the breeder, the most important breeding goal is for sure the kernel yield. Beside of that, we see some other important traits which are coming up, such as resistant against lodging, and which is very important to know for the Baltic countries, early maturity for a safe harvest for the farmers. These are some breeding goals which we focus on in the nearest future. And beside of that, we have quality traits like Weissin and Kornweissin and tannin. These are two ingredients which are important for the breeders as well. We also do breeding in winter types, but this is something special for the Western countries like France and UK. Below of this slide, we can see the differences in flowering for the beans. We have, for example, the tannin-free varieties, which are white-flowered. And beside of that, we have the, let's say, standard varieties, which has colored flowers. And also the Weissin and Kornweissin varieties are color flowered. If we talk about quality, we have to learn a bit more about these two quality points and which variety is behind that. We start with tannin-free varieties, which I mentioned as white flowers. They have a thinner skin, and this is to keep in mind. The tannins are located in the outer part of the skin, and this is why they are a little bit more sensitive regarding early sowing dates if we compare them to normal varieties. The second quality point are low Weissin and Kornweissin varieties, such as Tiffany or Victus, or the newer one, Addison and Bolivia. They have colored flowers and the skin is normal. That is because they have tannin, but they do not have Weissin and Kornweissin. These two ingredients are located inside the kernel, and this is, let's say, the advantage of this new breeding effort. It has no optical differences to other varieties, and it has no impact on kernel and protein yield. And this is what gives the farmer a plus in growing. If we have a look at the results, I would like to start with a presentation of the German results from 2020. In Germany, our officials do testing of our listed varieties. In 2020, we have 28 locations, and the relative yield, 100 relative, was about 50 decitons per hectare, as you can see here. And we see that the green graphs reaches a higher yield over all these locations, and we see that the newer varieties do a plus in the yield. This is something which is not only in the German country. If we have a look at the Baltic states, here we have 2 years results from 2019 and 20. And if we have a look at the red border, this is the average yield over the 2 years, 100. And we see that the average yield depends on the years. In 2019, we had an average yield about 5.7 tons per hectare. And what is very nice to see is that in 2020, we had an average yield over 8 tons per hectare. Some varieties reaches even higher yields than 8 tons. And this is linked together to your good soil content, to a good water content in the soil, and to an adapted growing. So if we talk about a successful growing of pulses, how can we improve it? That's what we see here. We have the general recommendation for growing field beans and peas, and each crop, each bean and pea has their own recommendation. And I would like to start with the beans on the left part, which has for sure a higher 1000 kernel weight. It is something between 350 and up to 700. It's depending a little bit on the year. The sowing density, I would like to focus on the summer types. The best sowing density is between 30 and 50 kernels per square meter. And it depends on the date of sowing. The later we sow, the higher we have to adjust the sowing density. Sowing depth is linked to the water capacity for the kernels. The deeper we sow, the better it is for the bean. We would recommend up to 10 centimeter. If you reach more or less 6 or 7, it is quite well. The sowing date is very important. Don't sow too early, but also don't sow too late. And this is what sounds very easy, but in the past years we saw that it is very difficult to reach the perfect sowing date because you never know what the weather will be. And we see the next point, the frost tolerance is low for the summer types. And therefore, in general, we can say the sowing date between the middle of February up to the beginning of April will be a good time for you to calculate with the sowing. Beans like very heavy soils or middle heavy soils. They have a high 1000 kernel weight and they are strong against climate conditions which are a bit rough, and they are strong in their youth development. That is why they like heavy soils. The drought tolerance is low, and this is something I would like to show you on the next slide. But to summarize it for the beans, they are starting their maturity from August to the middle of September, depending a little bit on the location and on the variety. And you have to keep in mind that the growing cycle has to be at least 4 years, that you don't come too close from one bean to the next growing. To summarize it for the peas, it's a little bit different. The peas like lighter soils. They like light up to middle soils. They have a lower 1000 kernel weight, they need 80 to 100 kernels per square meter for the sowing rate, and they do not have to sow as deep as the beans. 4 or 6 centimeters are enough, and you can compare it to the sowing depths with grains. They are also sensitive against frost, and that is why the sowing has to be a little bit later than the beans, because they are more sensitive against frost. And this is what leads to the general recommendation to sow in the end of March or in the beginning of April. Their maturity is earlier than the beans, and this leads to a very good following crop development. You can sow even winter oilseed rape after the peas, because they will be harvested in the end of July or in the middle of August. The growing cycle has to be more than 6 years to avoid some diseases which comes from the soil. In my last slide, I mentioned the drought tolerance, and this is something which is a key point in growing pulses. I would like to show you data from a research done in Germany over 4 years on 77 farms, practical farmers, conventional and ecological farmers, and they did research to analyze the link between the water in the soil and the yield. And we see here the precipitation and irrigation in liter per square meter, and this was measured 2 weeks after sowing until 3 weeks before harvest. And this is the time where the plants has their need of water. To summarize it, it doesn't matter if it's conventional or ecological farming. The higher water content we have inside the soil, the higher we get the yield out of it. This is for the beans. If we have a look at the peas, the same graph, the peas don't need as much water as the beans, because they are smaller, they are a little bit easier to handle, and they are satisfied with the water content between 200 and 300 liter per square meter in this period I mentioned. And this is what I would like to show to you, because to keep in mind that the peas are well adapted to lighter soils with a lack of water, and the beans, they are more adapted to heavy soils, to more water content. We have here an overview of some important diseases and pests in the pulses, and to have a look at the most important ones, we start with the early one, Citona lineatus. It comes to the field very early, from beginning of emerging up to the stage of 6 or 8 leaves. They eat the leaves, they drop down the eggs, and the eggs goes inside the soil. The small larvae damages the roots, and this is something what we as a farmer has to keep in mind. We have a second box here, the aphids. The aphids are the vectors for viruses. They start their flying from beginning of flowering. And a third insect, which is very important to manage in the fields, is the bean seed beetle. On the downer part of this slide, we see the diseases such as Escochyta or Botrytis, and the rust, and all these diseases has to be noticed in the field up from the beginning of flowering until the harvest. I mentioned the bean seed beetle. It flies inside the field, the colonization of the field at the beginning of flowering. The seed beetle goes inside the young pods. This is what we can see here. It lays down an egg on the pods. This small larvae goes inside the pods. The young kernels are infected and damaged, and this is what we see later after harvesting the small insect or these damages inside the kernel. And here are some advices for you to keep in mind. What is the most important point is an intensive field and surrounding inspection, and this has to be done in small periods of time, from days, to go to the field, search for this insect, and if it is present in the field, react with spraying. Don't wait too long, because 2 days, which are warmer than 20 degrees, might lead to the beetles fly to the fields. And this is the point or the time where you have to be in the field to observe this insect and to react. After a short period, they drop down the eggs on the young, small developing pods. This is what we saw on the last slide with these small yellow eggs. And the spraying has to be done before they drop their eggs down. My next topic is the seed processing, and this is something which is beside the agronomical advices, the second important point in growing pulses, because it is a little bit different like growing or seed processing grains. And here are some advices to avoid losses or damages during harvest. How can we adjust the combine? If we talk about beans, we can start harvesting about 18% of moisture. The pods will be easily threshed, so don't worry about might be too wet. It is perfect for the beans, around 18%. If you wait for drier periods, the moisture content goes down, but the seed crop quality may be reduced because there might be a risk of broken kernels inside the combiner. After the combining, the drying has to be slow and gentle to the beans, so not too much temperature. The ambient air has to be something like 30 or 40 degrees, but not more. The storage afterwards should be done in dark areas to save the seed quality over the autumn and over the winter for the next season. Quite the same picture for the peas. Now, peas should be also harvested at the right time. But what is the right time for peas? We talk about below 12% moisture content, the seed might be split and crack. So if we go a little bit more with the water content, they can be early combining around 18 to 20% of moisture content. It is the period where the plants are quite completely yellow, but there are some green parts left from the stem which stay green. And this is the perfect time for harvesting peas. Afterwards, it is the same as for the beans. A careful drying helps to keep up the quality of the seeds. I would like to go a little bit into details regarding the combine settings, especially for field beans, and to focus on medium crop condition, we do it as an example. regarding the thrashing drum speed, it is compared to grain harvest a little bit less of speed. We have about 550 to 650, something like that, rounds per minute, together with the concave, which is open very wide because the diameter of the beans is very high compared to grains. We have something like 15, 17 up to 20, 22 in front. We have to open up the sieves as much as possible, and together with a strong fan speed we reaches a very good cleaning condition in the combines, and this is very important if we talk about harvesting beans. The same figure now for the peas. The peas are smaller as the beans, and therefore we have to adjust the speed of the thrashing drum or the rotor speed. So let's say about 100 rounds per minute less compared to the beans. The concave has to be adjusted a little bit smaller. The sieves, they have to close a little bit, that we are about 10, 12 up to 15 millimeters depending on the situation in field. And the fan speed does not have to be as high as the beans. What comes next after the harvest is the storage, and I therefore would like to give you an example of our storage here at the breeding station, how we organize the traveling, the storage at NPZ. And if we talk about moving beans or peas, we avoid the high falls of the grains to lower the seed damages, because they are very sensitive. They have a small skin and the tester might be damaged otherwise. Therefore, we used hanging sails like it is shown here on the right, or we do gum coating at the augers. We used high or bigger auger conveyor to move a higher volume with a slower speed of the auger. And you might know it from potatoes in the trailers. We use these gum bands to lower the falling of the beans. This is the example of our cleaning machinery, and I would like to focus on some key points inside this cleaning facility. We organized it with this gum coating surface to minimize these mechanical damages of the grains, and we avoid vertical falls. We adjust the angle up to 45 degrees to lower these falls and to do it in a flatter way. After the cleaning is done, the perfect moisture content for storage is about 14% for and storage over winter. In the end of my presentation, I would like to summarize the most important key points I mentioned. I've spoken about the growing area in the European countries, and we recognize a rising area year by year. Especially in the Baltic states, we have over 100,000 hectares of field bean production, which is very nice to have it. And we believe to strengthen this in the nearest future. Our breeding efforts offered a wide range portfolio of field beans, and the special qualities I've mentioned, these Weissin, Convaisin content and also the tannin contents, they offer a possibility of entering new markets such as human consumption or feeding laying hens. We had high yield potential last year in 2020 in the Baltic states. And this is something which is linked together with the last point with the water capacity in the soil, which is the key to successful growing pulses. Our breeding efforts leads to new varieties which are in the testing process, and we will get in the nearest future more varieties adapted to the pulse growing market. The beans and peas in general, the pulses, they help to diversify and to extend the duration of the crop rotation and reduce fertilizers. In the actual discussion of the agriculture, this is a plus for the farmer. We have shown some recommendation for the successful growing, which helps the farmer for the pulses in the future. With this, I would like to end up with my presentation. Thank you for your attention and hope to see you again in the nearest future, maybe in the Baltic states.